good evening, everyone. Welcome to the OSU Library on this very nice, balmy October evening. I'm David Oberhelman, and along with my colleague Barbara Miller, we're the two co-directors of the Great War and Its Legacy series. This is a multi-year, multidisciplinary series on the impact of World War I upon the United States, Payne County, as well as world culture. And tonight we're very pleased to have Dr. John Dobson, whom many of you might remember, who was a former Dean of Arts and Sciences. And tonight Barbara is going to do the introduction for Dr. Dobson. So Barbara?
I'll do this and then you'll have to pull it back up. All right, John Dobson. Many of you know John. He's a emeritus. Are you emeritus dean, would that be considered, of arts and sciences here at OSU?
Well, in the graduate catalog, I am.
Yeah.
In the other one, I'm not.
Okay.
But I claim it. Yeah.
He claims it, okay. Yeah. He's also an assistant provost for research at Iowa State, and he has taught at universities in Scotland and Ireland. He specializes in, you had a degree from MIT. We've had a string of MIT-related talks this week. As history and physics from MIT, and a PhD from Wisconsin in history. And John specializes in political, diplomatic, business history, particularly early 20th century. He's written several books, and the most recent one, I'm going to get all the B's mixed up, Belligerence, Brinkmanship, and the Big Stick. Which is a sort of encyclopedia of foreign policy concepts, and this has extensive coverage on the causes and the conduct and consequences of America's decisions, first to not enter and later to enter in the World War I conflict. John?
I want to apologize for the belligerence and the big stick. The first book I wrote in that series was Bulls, Bears, Boom, and Bust, which made a lot more sense, but anyway. When I put this title up, my wife always proofreads my thing, so if there are any mistakes in here, they're all hers. She said, well, why'd you use a word like belligerent? Well, I happen to know that word, and I think it's right. When I was negotiating for this gig with Barbara, she said she wanted me to talk a little bit about the economic. You know, I'm going to do a lot of diplomatic, but also economic. And so I thought, as I looked at it, I'm going to talk about reluctant belligerent, a country that didn't want to get into this thing. And yet, at the same time, the United States was the only country involved that had a huge benefit from participating in the Great War. So it was kind of fun to put that package together. So let's get into it. I've got way more material than I need. And one of the more difficult things is to give this talk to an audience with several history professors and some people who may know quite a bit less. The only saving grace is none of you were actually there. So whatever I say will be okay. Okay, I'm going to look at four basic topics here. Why was there a Great War? Because in order to understand why we weren't going into it right away, you have to understand what was at stake. Why did the United States delay entering the Great War? When I was teaching in the British Isles, this was the question that I got frequently from my students. What were you guys doing for 2.5 years? We got this great thing going on and you're sitting over there doing nothing. Well, there's plenty of reason why the United States didn't want to get involved in this thing. So I'll cover that a little bit too. Why did we finally get into it? I think that's an interesting question as well, because essentially there was no reason for us to get in, and yet we did, so we have to talk about that as well. And then finally, how did the United States benefit from the Great War? And I'll cover that toward the end. So let's get right away going on why was there a Great War? Well, I've got four things up here. There are probably 5,000. But I'm going to look at these four. Collapse of the balance of power, secret diplomacy, and I say secret diplomacy gone wrong, rigid military alliances and plans, and then of course the assassination at Sarajevo. So let's look at the balance of power situation. There was a balance of power in Europe, more or less, that really dates back to 1815 when the Congress of Vienna met after the second defeat of Napoleon. And what happened after that period, for about 55 years, there really was a balance. The French had the biggest army, the British had the biggest navy, Germany was a bunch of little nothing states. And so there was no real internal dynamic that would cause a big European war. So the balance of power actually existed. However, almost immediately there were all kinds of deals made. And let me move right on to the guy who destroyed the balance of power. His name's Otto von Bismarck. He was chancellor of the Kingdom of Prussia in the early 1860s. And he was very interested in doing what Garibaldi had done in Italy, which was to bring all the German principalities together into one big empire, a German empire. So in order to do that, he created a war with Austria. The Austro-Hungarian Empire was a big operation next door. And they argued over a couple of little provinces called Schleswig and Holstein, which are actually way up there in the north under Denmark. The Austrians thought they belonged to them. He says, no, it's Prussian. And so they went into this war. And the war lasted 7 weeks. The Austro-Prussian War lasted exactly 7 weeks. The Germans or the Prussians won, and so that was wonderful. But as a result, they linked together a lot of this stuff across the North German area, and it became the North German Confederation. Still no problem, but it unbalanced the situation enough that Louis Napoleon, who had taken over in France in the after the 1848-1849 issue, he felt he had to step in and demonstrate that they still had the biggest army in Europe. So Bismarck was more than willing to accommodate him. He faked a letter and tricked Napoleon the French into declaring war in 1870. And we have the Franco-Prussian War. Lasted 7 weeks. No, excuse me, 6 weeks. Only 6 weeks this time. The first one was 7 weeks. And as a result of that, the Germans, linking together all the German territories, added Alsace and Lorraine, which had been under French control. So this creates the sore point, the rub, that's going to cause a great deal of trouble down the line, because the French now feel it's up to them to get that back. And Bismarck understood that. So what are the lessons of the Franco-Prussian War? First, wars last about 6 weeks, because the last two had. The balance of power was gone. France wanted revenge, so France had to be isolated. And that meant that Bismarck had to have all the Allies nailed down. So he immediately began this diplomatic push to link together Allies who would therefore not team up with France, because France couldn't do it on their own. So the first part of this came in 1873. It's called the Dreikaiserbund, the Three Emperor Union, and it involves Russia, Austria, and Germany. Now it's the German Empire. This consolidated thing is the German Empire. So there are three Kaisers, the three emperors. This was really a mutual non-aggression pact. They just agreed they wouldn't go to war with each other. It's not the same thing as a mutual defense pact, which we'll get into later. So all they were agreeing was that they wouldn't fight each other. Suppose France declared war, none of these would fight with France, and they wouldn't fight with each other. So France is isolated, good deal. However, in 1881, the Russians kind of dropped out of it. And at that point, Bismarck sets up another triple alliance, this one with Austria, Germany, and Italy. And I've doubled the line there between Germany and Austria, because this now becomes a mutual defense pact. If one country is attacked, the other will go to its aid. But Bismarck's not done. In 1883, he negotiated a really super secret thing called the Reinsurance Treaty, which again brought Russia into his sphere. And you see, France is still isolated. And then in a real coup, in 1887, he creates the Mediterranean Agreements between England, Italy, Spain, and Austria, and again, France is excluded. This is brilliant diplomacy. So it's a wonderful moment in Bismarck's career. It's kind of ironic there are the Mediterranean agreements, and that whole bottom part of France is in the Mediterranean, but they're out of it. Okay, so everything's fine. Until Wilhelm II, the son of the original emperor, becomes emperor in 1890. And he's young, and he doesn't want to listen to this old guy, Bismarck, who needs him. And so the Russian reinsurance treaty lapsed in 1890, and Wilhelm decided he didn't need it. So we are left with the Triple Alliance. And the French moved in immediately. In 1891, a year later, they began having military and naval conversations with the Russians, and in 1894, there is a Franco-Russian alliance. What's this alliance for? Well, it's not exactly clear, but France has finally got an ally. In 1898, France and England, which had been in a colonial contest over Africa, had a confrontation up the Nile River at a place called Fashoda, and the French blinked, and the British got their Cape to Cairo thing that Cecil Rhodes wanted. And at that point then, this colonial hostility kind of began to fade, and in 1904, the British signed the Entente Cordiale with France. It's not a mutual defense pact, but it's more of a just an agreement that, you know, we're kind of on the same side. And then, to make matters worse, in 1907, the British made an agreement with the Russians. Now, I've got the dashed lines there because by 1907, the Italians were saying, what are we doing here? We got to get out of this. So technically, they're still part of the First Triple Alliance, but they don't want to be in that mutual defense pact. They don't want to be obligated to go to war if something bad happens. The Germans now face an awful situation. They face the prospect of a two-front war between Russia and France attacking Germany. So they got a plan for it, and happily, they have a master planner, Field Marshal Alfred Graf von Schlieffen. And von Schlieffen looked at this thing and he said, okay, here's the plan. And this is 1906, he lines this up. Here are the elements of the plan. Germany can't win a two-front war. They know that. So if war comes, France and Russia will ally against Germany. We can't win that. So what we'll do is, Russia will take at least 3 months to mobilize. So we should invade France first and knock it out of the war. How long will that take? 6 weeks. We know wars last 6 weeks, right? If it's going to take the Russians 3 months to mobilize and we nail the French in 6 weeks, then we can turn all of our forces against Russia. So that's a great plan. It's put in the file cabinet, and that's it. Now, there are modifications over time, but fundamentally, that's the plan. So the Germans have the plan for the two-front war. What's the war about? Nobody knows. There's really no objective in this thing except that these alliances are lined up and it could happen any time, but there's no reason for it. Except that in 1914, a reason showed up. During the period from in the 1880s and 90s and into the early 1900s, there's a lot of controversy and fighting over the Balkans, which were Ottoman Empire provinces that both the Austrians and the Russians were interested in, and there were a series of Balkan wars, which are important to those people obviously in them, but were not part of this major Western European situation. And by 1914, the Austrians had the best of it, and they had taken on control of a place, provinces called Bosnia and Herzegovina. And so everything's kind of calm in 1914. And I'm sure you'll all remember that song out of the movie Mary Poppins. the father of the family. It's 1910, and his song is, "It's great to be an Englishman in 1910. Everything was just so great at that point. But they decided, because they welcomed Bosnia and Herzegovina in, that they ought to send a high-level delegation to welcome them into the Austrian Empire. So they chose Franz Ferdinand, who was the Archduke, and his wife Sophie. Now, Franz Ferdinand shouldn't have been the Archduke, but his older brother had this assignation in Meierling, and they either committed suicide or somebody killed him or something like that. So this guy isn't even the main pick, but he's now the Archduke. He's going to succeed Franz Ferdinand, the grand old man of the Austrian Empire. So they show up there, they get into that car, and the car drives down the wrong street, and a guy named Prince jumps he thought the thing was over, but my God, there they are. He jumps out, he was having a coffee off to the side. He jumps out and shoots him point blank dead. Well, who is this guy? He's a Serbian nationalist. He's actually a member of a terrorist group called the Black Hand. There is an independent Serbia, and there are people who think that Bosnia and Herzegovina should be part of Serbia. And so these guys are terrorists, just like the ones we have around now with all these problems around the Middle East. And so they're just trying to create an event that'll cause some trouble. The Austrians decide that they can't take this lying down. After all, their archduke, their second most person in their empire, has been shot. So they first check with Berlin. And they say, "Hey, we want to go after these Serbians. Is it okay?" And the Germans said, that might actually trigger this whole big war. But it's okay. Go ahead and do it." This is called the blank check. Okay, so the Austrians then muck around for 4 weeks and then finally send an ultimatum to Serbia saying, "We're going to invade your country, and we're going to round up all the members of the Black Hand, all the terrorists, and what are you going to do about that?" Well, the Serbians look at this map, and they discover that there are some lines I didn't include on the earlier one. For example, there's a line here. There's actually an alliance between Russia and Serbia, because the Russians and the Austrians are not friends, and so it's a mutual defense pact. If Serbia is attacked by Austria, then the Russians will come to their help. So the Serbians check with St. Petersburg, and they say, "Okay, what are we supposed to do? Can we ignore all this?" And the Russians say, "Yeah, fine, we'll come to your aid if they do something." So the Serbians reject the ultimatum. The Austrians march into Serbia. But wait a minute, this is bad. The Germans open up the file drawer, and there's only one file in it. It's the Schlieffen Plan, and it says we have to beat the French before the Russians mobilize, and the Russians are mobilized. Oh my God, we got to attack France. So they decided to declare war on France. France says, "Whoa, we didn't even know we were in this war, and we're into it." Okay. Now, in order to get to France to fulfill the Schlieffen Plan, the Germans have to march in like this. The French, of course, think this might be an opportunity to go back and get Alsace-Lorraine, so they send their armies out that way. And the swinging door is happening, and pretty soon Germany is going to control France, and France is going to control Germany. But it didn't quite happen that way. But there's a problem here, because this top line goes right through Belgium. Let me check my alliance plan here. Oh my gosh, there's an alliance between England and Belgium. Oh, that's okay, there's an alliance between Germany and Belgium too. This dates back to the 1850s. So the British say, "Aha, you can't invade Belgium. You have a treaty that you won't do that." And the German response was, and I can't say it in German, but that's just a scrap of paper. So now the British say, "Well, we got to be in this because you violated this treaty we have with the Belgians." So in a matter of, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 days, these alliances are all at war with each other. And what happened was that the Russians, to everyone's surprise, including mostly the Russians, managed to round up a couple of armies to send into East Prussia. And so the Germans had to suddenly go after them. It didn't take them 3 months after all. And that weakened their attempt to attack France. And so we get this line. The British come in, fortify the line. Whoops. And that's where we are. Really in the middle of September of 1914. So that's a quick run through why there was a war. Now, if you're sitting in Scotland and you're saying, what were you Americans doing? You didn't come over here. Why would we go there? You know, I mean, why would we go there at all? This war has nothing to do with the United States. It's not clear that even the combatants knew what they were going to do. And in fact, over the next 2 years, they signed a bunch of secret treaties to outline what they were going to do. The French and the British decided to divide up the Middle East. They conned Italy into the war on their side. They promised Russia stuff. They didn't even know what they were fighting for either. It was just this thing happened. So the United States was well advised to stay out of it. So why did we delay getting into the war? I've already given you the idea there's nothing in it for us. But there are some actual reasons. President Woodrow Wilson. He's not in favor of war. He's not a warmonger. He doesn't want to get involved over there. And he cites things like the Monroe Doctrine of 1823. Now, I'm sure you're all very well aware of what the Monroe Doctrine says, but you probably didn't know it said this. Our policy in regard to Europe is not to interfere in the internal concerns of any of its powers. We promised to stay out of Europe if they stayed out of the Western Hemisphere. So our policy for 90 years has been, we're going to leave you guys alone and we'll do our stuff. And you leave us alone. So there's the Monroe Doctrine. Can't overwhelm that. We have no pre-existing alliances with anybody. We did have an alliance once. Ran from 1788 to 1801. It was the alliance with the French that Ben Franklin signed that got us through the Revolutionary War. And it turned out to be a huge diplomatic problem after the war, because the French wanted us to join the Napoleonic Wars at that point, but the wars with England in the 1790s, and we didn't want to be in it. And so finally, in 1801, we got out of it. And it had been so annoying and so awkward that we never got into another alliance. And in fact, we didn't sign an alliance with anybody until 1949, which is the NATO alliance. So we didn't have any map with little bars running around telling us what to do. We also have a huge population of what were called hyphenate Americans. They were from Germany, from Ireland, and from some of the other Eastern European countries. And they didn't want to go to war against Germany or Austria. The Irish wanted the British to leave them alone and get out of there, and so a lot of them were cheering the fact that the British got themselves bollocked up in a war. So there's a huge millions of Americans, Irish Americans, German Americans, and other hyphenate Americans, who didn't want to get involved in this war at all, and certainly not on the side that we eventually entered on. So why did the United States stay out of the war so long? A lot of reasons here. Another reason is we had a crummy little army. I'll talk about that in a little while. We only had 200,000 people in the American army, while the other countries have millions. So we don't even have an army to go to war with. So there's no reason to get us involved. We also have a long tradition of isolationism that dates all the way back to the beginning. It's part of the Monroe Doctrine. We have always tried to stay out of other people's business. And there was never a direct attack on America. So we had no reason to get involved. And there's a whole diplomatic history ethos about the first shot. The United States never gets into a war until the first shot has been fired. you know, at Lexington and Concord, at Sports Sumter, the Maine blows up, Taylor is in across the Nueces River, and they gets attacked. So we have this tradition that we don't go to war unless we're attacked, unless we're George W. Bush. But that's getting too far in advance. Okay, so there's no reason for us to get into this war. Oh wait, there was a direct attack. I'm sorry, I misled you. The Lusitania was sunk by a submarine. When we were in Ireland, my wife and I were in Ireland in June, and our guide is showing us around, and he takes us down to this place called Cove. It's actually C-O-B-H, but the Irish can't spell. It's called Cove, and he says, well, there's where the Lusitania was sunk, and that got the United States into the war. Well, no, it actually didn't. 122 Americans were killed, but the Secretary of State was William Jennings Bryan. And he said, no way, those Americans just shouldn't have been on that ship. They shouldn't be there. They attacked a British ship. Why are the Americans standing there? That's silly. So even the attack, which killed Americans, was not good enough to get us over the hump, particularly with all these other factors I've talked about, to get us into the war. It's actually 23 months later, after the Lusitania sinks, that we get into the war. Okay, so I've told you why we shouldn't have been in the war. Now I'm going to talk about why we finally did. Okay, why did the United States finally enter the Great War? Well, the war lasted too long. It wasn't over in 6 weeks. It wasn't over in 3 months. Those of you who've been watching or did watch Downton Abbey know that Crawley went off to fight, and he said, oh, we'll be back by Christmas of 1914. The war just didn't end. If the war lasted 6 weeks or 6 months or even a year, the United States would never have gotten involved, but it lasted too long. So that's one of the reasons. American war loans. Okay, guys, now we're talking good economic determinism. For a long time, there were a group of historians, particularly in the 1930s, who felt that we had been conned into the war by economic factors. These war loans, if we hadn't loaned money to these people over there, we wouldn't have had a stake in it, wouldn't have been a good deal. But what are these war loans? In 1914, the United States had the largest industrial capacity of any country in the world. And so a lot of the Europeans wanted to tap American resources to fight the war. Well, not exactly. The Germans were already, you know, they're Germans, they'd be ready. They were prepared for the six-month war. They had enough supplies to last the 6 months the war was going to last. The British and the French, forget it. So almost immediately, the British and the French wanted to get busy buying American stuff. And they had a lot of investments in the United States. And in fact, the situation got so rocky that they decided to close the New York stock market in July of 1914 because they were worried that the British and French would sell all of their shares to make money available to buy stuff. The stock market was closed for 8 months while this thing worked its way out. Almost overnight, the United States entered a new phase in its international economic sphere. The United States had been a debtor nation ever since the colonial period, more European money invested in America than elsewhere. By 1914, there was still about $6 billion of European investment in American securities and American operations, and the United States had about $3 billion invested in Mexico and Central America and so on. But all of a sudden, we get a favorable balance of trade. All of a sudden, we are a creditor nation. We're way ahead of the game. And if I've organized these slides right, which I'm not sure. Well, these are exports. Look at that huge increase in exports. The rectangle is the period during the war. There's a huge increase in American exports, and it has wonderful consequences. This is the first big benefit of the war in the fact that the balance of trade is way in favor of the United States. We'd love to have this now. This looks like China's balance of trade against the United States now, but in those days, we're just swimming in international credits. We're swimming in international credits so much so that the British and the French very quickly run out of money. J.P. Morgan Jr., the son of the original big financier, inherited his father's connections with European operations. So both France and Britain hired J.P. Morgan Jr. to be their agent in the United States. And J.P. Morgan went to the government and said, "These guys have run out of cash. What should I do?" Secretary of State William Jennings Bryan said, "Can't lend them money. Money is the worst of all contraband because it commands all others. We can't get involved in that." Well, in a couple of weeks, President Wilson said, "Well, not so fast here," because every 3 or 3.5 years, the United States had had an economic recession, starting back in 1897, 1901, 1903, 1907, 1911. It's coming up for another one in 1911 or 1914. And this would be very embarrassing because Wilson had just rammed through his totally controlled Democratic Congress things like the Federal Reserve System and several other progressive programs. And it would be very embarrassing to have done all that and then have a recession. And there will be a recession if the British and the French can't buy. So Wilson says, is there a way around this? And so Morgan says, "Well, how about if I just issue a line of credit? I'll just give them credit." "Okay, good, good." William Jennings Bryan, no, that's a terrible one. So they began to run up IOUs, credits. And this stimulated the American economy and the American exports. You know, boy, everything's going great. And then in the spring, J.P. Morgan said, "I can't keep doing this. I've run out of credit capability. We have to do something else. Can they borrow money from us?" Ooh, boy, that really is kind of over the line. Can they borrow money from us? But Wilson is sufficiently aware of and concerned about the health of the American economy, he kind of reluctantly says, "Yeah, okay, you can do that." So immediately they bring out a $500 million French and British loan. You can buy British and French loans or bonds in the United States. So then this is a good deal for the Americans, because what do they do with the money that they get from the sale of the bonds? They buy American stuff. So it's a great stimulus to the American economy. Now the economic determinists say, okay, that's it. That's why we got involved in the war, because we ran up so much, the Europeans ran up so much debt that we had to go to war to collect it. And here's what it looked like in the spring of 1917. Germany had finally started buying stuff because, of course, the war lasted more than 6 months. And they had bought about $100 million worth of stuff. Meanwhile, the Allies had borrowed $2.3 billion. And I want to put a little marker in here. I'm talking about billions here like it's a lot. It was way a lot in those days. Today, $1 billion just funds Donald Trump's summer vacation. But $1 billion in 1914 was a lot. Okay, so you say, oh, okay, well, if we've got to go to war. Who are we going to go to war with? We'll go to war with the Allies, because otherwise they won't let you pay us back. This sounds like a very good reason, except that we spent $35 billion on the war. So I don't know about your math, but it seems to me spending 15 times as much money as the debt to collect it, to make sure you collect it, is not a good deal. So the economic argument has a kind of a weakness here. It doesn't really hold water. So we got to find other reasons. Why were the other reasons? The war lasted too long. The American debts are there. British propaganda. They were fantastic at propaganda. Almost immediately, they cut the cable connecting mainland Europe with America, and all the news we got about the war came over the British cable. And that would have been bad enough if we were getting news directly from real sources in England, but the English government, the British government, was very much censoring news from the battlefield. So we were getting our news from censored reports from the British government. And here's where we get the idea that the Germans were spearing babies with their helmet things and all this stuff. A tremendous effort by the British to convince the Americans that the Germans were the Huns. They called them the Huns. They were this horrible scourge that had to be wiped out. And I put in parentheses the Zimmerman note. This is a note that the British intercepted that the Germans had sent to the Mexican government in the spring of 1917 saying, hey, you guys, why don't you join us in fighting America and we'll help you get back your possessions from the Mexican War. You can have back, well, they could have back Arizona, New Mexico, California, and Texas. We'll help you get those back. Well, the Mexican government, of course, had no idea that this would work or wanted to do it anyway. But the British very carefully filtered this into the propaganda about how these Germans are terrible guys, and we got to do something. So that all is part of the reason why we finally enter the war. I don't have it in here. Oh, I do have it in here. The Russian Revolution. The Russian Revolution took place early in 1917. And you probably don't remember the Russian Revolution very well, but there was about an 8-month period when there was a government headed up by a guy named Kerensky, and it was fundamentally a democratic government. The Bolsheviks under Lenin and Trotsky took over in the fall of the October Revolution in 1917. But at the time Wilson's considering getting into the war, he suddenly can say, we want to make the world safe for democracy. All the democratic governments are fighting on one side. We should join them. The French, the British, and the Russians, all are democratic governments fighting autocratic empires, Germany, Austria, the Ottoman Empire, and Romania. So the Russian Revolution is important. Now, of course, it doesn't go the way Wilson wants it, but it's there as a reason why now is the time and we know which side to get in on. And then there's unrestricted submarine warfare. This guy, Grand Admiral Henning von Hötzendorf, was the Schlieffen of the Navy. And he told everybody, we can deal with this situation by cutting England off from American supplies. He was so dedicated to this, and he was nobody paying attention to him, so he finally quit. He resigned in a huff. But his idea was, if we unleash this submarine fleet that we've been building, the submarine fleet can do such extensive damage to the sources or the transport system bringing stuff in from the United States that the British will be forced to surrender within 6 months. And so the question was, well, won't that make the Americans get into the war? Oh, yeah, sure, but it'll take them 2 years to mobilize. Where have I heard this before? Take 2 years for it? It's the Schlieffen plan for the Navy. So in January 31st, the German embassy notified the United States government that henceforth there would be unrestricted submarine warfare. So we finally have a definite attack on the United States. So immediately Woodrow Wilson didn't go to war. It took until April. But it was pretty devastating. So that's why that answers our first questions. Why didn't we get involved in the war? Had nothing to do with us. We had all these good reasons not to, and yet we finally did because of the changes that I've described here. So, we got the call. We woke up and we got the call. So, how did the United States benefit from the Great War? You're happy to see that I'm down to the bottom of my chart here. Well, I've of course got three more lines that I haven't shown you, but anyway, here we go. All right, is that the, whoop, let me get back here. Yeah, okay. There are three requisites for war: money, manpower, and material. And I want to say politically incorrectly that it was manpower. There were no WACs or WAFs or any of that stuff. There were some auxiliary women's groups, but they were confined to medical care. So it really is manpower at that time. Okay, how much money do we need? First of all, let me say one thing about why the German naval Schlieffen plan failed. The reason it failed was money and the Navy. Almost immediately after Woodrow Wilson got Congress to approve the War Declaration on April 2nd, 1917, the government lent England and France billions more dollars, directly government to government, no longer waiting around for guys to pay for bonds, just lent them money. So this is a huge shot in the arm to these two allied countries. The second thing that the Germans hadn't really figured on is that the United States had the third largest navy in the world at that time. They had the second largest navy, but the British had very effectively blockaded it in Kiel Harbor, and it was only the submarines that could really get out. So the addition of the third largest navy to the first largest navy made a huge difference in the Navy's ability to convoy ships and offset the submarine warfare. There was still huge damage. The Germans were sinking, I don't know, 100 million tons a month and all this stuff, but the American Navy was available, and that undid the concept that we can just run over them. Okay, let's look at money. Americans usually fought wars on borrowed money. If you know anything about the Civil War, for example, there were huge bond sales and all of that stuff. We had hardly any real tax income to draw on, and so we borrowed money. But in this particular case, that's a huge increase in federal expenditures. The yellow is civilian or non-military, the red is the Army alone, and the blue is the Navy. So where are we going to get that much money? We're talking up to $18 billion in that one period there, $32 billion altogether. Happily, in 1916, the government had approved the 16th Amendment, which allowed for a federal income tax. And they had immediately installed a federal income tax with a confiscatory rate of 7% on the highest incomes. Well, during the war, they just jacked it up to 70%. So we had a huge increase in tax revenues from the income tax, plus we had excise taxes and other tariffs and stuff like that. So about $11 billion of the needed money came through taxes. The rest of it was borrowed. And the independent buyers are individuals. There were four major bond selling drives by U.S. bonds, and the Americans, independent Americans, bought $17 billion worth of bonds, war bonds, and corporations bought about $4 billion. And of course, we get these wonderful posters, help stamp out the Kaiser, buy U.S. government bonds. And that's the third Liberty loan. There are three Liberty loans and one victory loan. And you buy a Liberty bond, lest I perish. That's the scariest Statue of Liberty I've ever seen. Let me get my checkbook out. Okay, so we financed this thing very effectively. tax money is the best way to go because you don't have to pay it back. Those people who did buy bonds eventually got all their money back. Not right away. Some of it was transferred into just regular treasury bills in the 1920s, but people really did get their money back who bought these bonds. So that's the money part of it. Now let's look at the manpower piece, both military and civilian. Here's military manpower. Which country in 1914 ranked with Serbia? United States. We had no army going. We had always previously relied on volunteers. You know the very famous moment in the spring of 1861 when there's the firing on Fort Sumter. What is Lincoln's first effort? He puts out a call for 75,000 volunteers. In the Spanish-American War, when that came along, volunteers were a huge part of it. Of course, the most famous volunteer was Teddy Roosevelt and the Rough Riders. They rounded up. The army was only about 75,000 at the time. They rounded up another 125,000 volunteers, and that was plenty to go off and beat up Spain. But even though there had been major preparedness efforts in the United States, even though they had built up the regular army because of fears of what might happen in 1916 and so on, we still have a pathetic army at the outset. And we have to get, as it turns out, 4 million. Where do you get them from? Well, you don't want to rely on volunteers. That's not a very good way to go anyway. So the government enlisted regular army enlistments of about 2 million people were enlisted in the regular service. And in 1917, Wilson introduced a draft and drafted another 2 million. So the 4 million is made up half of enlistees, people who volunteered, and people who were drafted. And even so, we still have the smallest army on that chart, except for Serbia. But that's still a lot of people. Here's the first one. No, I don't know if he's the first one, but he's one. Here are a bunch of them. What they did is the Germans were right that it took a while to train 4 million people who had not had military service beforehand. And it took quite a while to assemble them, equip them, and all of that stuff. And then getting them overseas was a problem as well. But the Germans were absolutely flummoxed by the fact that 14,000 American troops showed up in June of 1917, the first part of the so-called American Expeditionary Force. So they really did get over there very quickly. By October, Americans were in combat. And by the spring, by June of 1918, there were 1 million men in arms ready to fight. So it didn't take the 2 or 3 years that Holtzendorf had expected. They got there pretty darn fast. The commander was General John J. Pershing. His qualification for this assignment was that he had led the futile chase of Pancho Villa in New Mexico. They went down there and chased around in northern Mexico and didn't find him. But nevertheless, he was promoted to be in charge of the American Expeditionary Force. Pershing turned out to be the good guy in this because he insisted that the American units fight as American units. What the British and French wanted to do was to filter American troops into these demoralized French and British units that had lost half their men in previous battles. But Pershing held out for American independent operations. They began these independent operations. The 1 million people that were there, eventually another 1 million came over, but they were too late to participate in the combat. And they pulled off several important victories. I just read an interesting book, and I should have looked it up. It's something called The Myth of the Great War, in which this American writer takes a look at every single battle up till the very end and says that it's pretty amazing that the Allies lost every battle. The Germans won every battle up until then. It was only the arrival of the American Expeditionary Force that actually won the war. So it turned out to be a pretty important thing. About 53,000 were killed, Americans were killed, 135,000 casualties, but 25,000 soldiers died of the flu. So, you know, looking at the statistics is kind of difficult because there are so many factors involved. So, that's the military manpower part of it. The civilian manpower part of it is kind of interesting as well. When you pull 4 million people out of the labor pool, you create huge gaps. And some of these gaps were filled by women taking jobs that they had never had an opportunity or wanted to take before in both business and industrial situations, on farms. Women really stepped up into a lot of positions here, which not as much as in the Second World War, but did fundamentally change the role of women in American society. About 400,000 black people came from poverty areas in the South and moved up to Detroit and Pittsburgh and New York looking for industrial jobs, which were empty because the white guys were off fighting. And so this was a huge demographic change that took place. And for a while it was beneficial to those black people who had jobs, better paying jobs than they ever would have had otherwise. But it caused a worse situation really after the war when the American troops were demobilized and they all came back and they were very resentful at this kind of person holding the jobs that they wanted to pick up in the civilian sector. Racism was never confined only to the South, and it really was enhanced enormously in the North as a result of this migration. The people who did the best were the unionized workers. This is Samuel Gompers, president of the American Federation of Labor, and he's been president. He was president for almost forever. He was out for a couple of years, but he was in basically the whole time. And these are the craft workers. These are the skilled workers. And so he was actually an English immigrant. And he was very pro the war effort. And so he said, we will not strike during the war. He was loyal to his new country and to his old country. So the AFL had a no-strike pledge. There were literally hundreds of little short-term work stoppages, but generally there were no major strikes during the war. And the reason it worked was that these people in the unions did very well indeed. Wages went up enormously, kept up with the cost of living. The government contract work, which a lot of this was, back in the, right before the war, they had passed a rule that government contract workers had to work for no more than 44 hours a week. If they did, they got overtime pay. So there was plenty of work for these people to do overtime. They got more pay than they'd ever imagined. So it was really the heyday of union support for the war, and they did very well. Unfortunately, like the situation with the agricultural workers in the South, after the war, the extra work stopped, wages stopped going up, and these people were very upset that things were no longer that way. Interestingly enough, salaried workers didn't get any raises at all. People who were on regular salary, a lot of government workers, didn't get any raises during the war, and so they relatively were worse off than the unionized workers. Okay, let's look at materiel. We'll look at agricultural first and then industrial. Obviously, there's a tremendous pressure on the industrial and the agricultural sectors to produce, because they're producing not only for a revived and very positive growth in the American economy, they're also producing food and material for the Allies as well. So it's a very, very intensive pressure on the situation, And one of the things that went up right away was agricultural prices. In fact, they got so out of whack that the President Wilson hired Herbert Hoover. Hoover was a mining engineer, and he had worked between 1914 and 1917 as a commission for the relief of Belgium, trying to make sure that the Belgian people who were now under German occupation didn't starve. And so he was then put in charge of the Food Administration in 1917, and he was given enormous power. He was given the authority to buy basically all the food that was shipped to the Allies, which was a huge amount of it. He also was given authority to equalize prices. And the Sugar Equalization Board, now here I'm getting into an area that Cindy, my wife, would hate this. This has to do with the sugar tariff. She hates the sugar tariff. I wrote a whole book about sugar, the sugar tariff. But sugar is important. Sugar comes from a whole bunch of sources. Sugar beets, sugar cane, Cuban sugar, Hawaiian sugar, and it has all different prices. So what the Sugar Equalization Board did is it bought all the sugar at whatever was a reasonable price and then sold sugar at a fixed price. So there's a lot of price control that comes out of the Food Administration. The Food Administration also was responsible for trying to train Americans to be careful about what they ate. And so we have these propaganda campaigns to try to make people realize that food is very important. Keep the home garden going. Here's another one. Eat more cornmeal, rye flour, oatmeal, and barley? Blech. We have to save the wheat for the fighters. So there's this huge campaign going on. And there are slogans like, say, Meatless Friday. You know, eat whatever you want, but on Friday, don't eat any meat. So I've got a picture of Meatless Friday. Anyway, see, it's getting late. I've got to get on with this. Okay, there's Meatless Friday. All right, in the industrial sector, we have to have the same kind of control that we have in the agricultural sector because there's a tremendous amount of overlapping demand. The Army and the Navy in the United States were two separate departments, the War Department and the Navy Department. And each department was subdivided into bureaus. And each of these bureaus, there were eight bureaus in the Navy, I don't know how many there were in the Army, each of these bureaus was responsible for a particular thing, ammunition, construction, general engineering, and so on. And so they would all issue orders. The Navy Bureau would issue a priority order for something. Well, pretty soon there's priority orders piling up everywhere, and nobody knew what the real priority was. So Wilson began to grapple with this as early as 1916. There was a Council of National Defense. It was made up by the Secretaries of Army, Navy, Commerce, Labor, and Agriculture. And that wasn't good enough because there was still no sorting them out of things. And so finally in late 1917, he formed the War Industries Board. And he appointed Bernard Baruch to run the War Industries Board. Baruch is known as the Lone Wolf of Wall Street. He didn't want to work for anybody or with anybody. He's really just a very, very effective guy. And he takes over, and by the spring of 1918, he's in charge of almost everything. He's supposed to create new production facilities. If they needed new factories to produce stuff that couldn't be produced, he helps build those factories. He converts existing plants to war production so that if you had an automobile factory, he arranges to have it converted into something that makes something for the military. And very importantly, establishes priorities among government orders because that breaks the logjam of everybody claiming that theirs was the most important priority. He allocates raw materials for war work. And this turns out to be very important. At one point, he sat down with the automobile manufacturing group, the Dodge brothers Ford wasn't there. William Durant was there from General Motors. And they all said, well, we're going to build a lot of cars this year. And he said, no, you're not. Well, yeah, we are. We're going to build cars. And he said, well, I'm not going to give you any steel to build cars. Oh, really? No. So he controls the raw materials and makes sure they go to war work. And the reason he can do this is he makes all the industrial purchases for the Allies and the American Armed Forces. So he has total control. This is the most controlling government agency that had existed in the United States up to that point. Very, very forceful. And it worked great. It sorted things out. Things went well. The problem was Wilson canceled it on January 1st, 1919. The peace treaty, or the truce came on November 11th. Less than 2 months later, he just cancels the War Industries Board. Thousands of contracts were out there. These companies were all waiting for orders that never came. So there's a huge collapse, a recession, as the thing kind of adjusts to the fact that nobody's controlling anything. But during the war, it was very effective. So here's a 1915 steel rolling mill. Here's a cannon factory. You know, the web's full of this stuff. It's just, if you say, you know, war production, you can get all kinds of cool stuff. You even get pictures of Meatless Friday. Okay, transportation's another part of all this. The United States had 230,000 miles of track run by hundreds of independent companies. And as soon as the transportation pressure came, they were all competing with each other, and it was a very messy situation. So Wilson took on the task of creating a U.S. Railway Administration, and he turned it over to his son-in-law, William McAdoo, who was Secretary of Treasury. And what they did is they basically nationalized the railway system overnight. They just took all of it, controlled it. They gave each individual company a fair share of what they would get under normal circumstances, and they were able to rationalize it the way Hoover was rationalizing agriculture production and Baruch was handling industrial production, and the railway system worked fabulously under this system. Labor, railroad workers benefited enormously. Everybody was doing well. The owners did well. And in fact, many people thought they should just leave it that way. You know, the British railway system was nationalized and it worked pretty well. But again, in January of 1920, a year later after the war was over, they gave it all back to the individual owners, including all the stuff they'd bought, gave them all the boxcars and stuff like that. But it, like the War Industries Board, while it was working, did a very good job. The U.S. Shipping Board was a flop. They finally managed to produce the first new ship in December of 1918. Well, no, everything doesn't work. There were 5,000 federal agencies created during the war to manage this stuff, many of which disappeared. They did, however, provide the blueprints for many New Deal programs that came along in the 1930s. The National Industrial Recovery Act, sometimes known as the NRA, the National Recovery Act, or National Recovery Administration, was modeled on the War Industries Board. So we did get some practice at things we might need down the line. So there we are. And now we're to the epilogue. See, I told you there was another bar on the chart. The United States and the world after the Great War. Look what the war did for the United States. This is U.S. gross domestic product. If you look at this, economists love to do this. Without the war, this line would go up like that. So our gross domestic product ended up more than double what we would have anticipated without the war. So this is a huge benefit. I've already shown you this chart, but you didn't look at the other end of it. Look how much more government expenditures there are after the war. Sure, there's before we're in a real laissez-faire period. We have this huge bump, but even afterwards, even though Warren G. Harding said we're going to go back to normalcy, we didn't. A lot of that stuff in the yellow line is soldiers' pensions, but the federal government is playing a much larger role in the economy after the war than it did before. So it's a permanent change. And we all are familiar with this. This is the Dow Jones Industrial Average from 1920 to 21. There is a recession there right after the war, 1920-21. And then things go up and it just goes gangbusters. So the stockholders thought things were doing great. This represents a huge increase in productivity. But where did it go? It didn't go to the workers. This is a chart of productivity, the red, and wages. Wages are flat, and productivity continues to go up. We had I was up at another university, and they had a young woman who's a student there who is now the chief economist for the Labor Department. And she had a chart of wage levels and productivity starting in 1970 to the present. And it looks just like this. So after the war, you know, we're kind of not doing very well. But we're doing better than some other people. This is the 14 points. Don't bother reading it. The thing that's not on here is reparations. Woodrow Wilson's plan for the post-war had no reparations in it. Now the Germans had forced the French to pay reparations after the Franco-Prussian War, so the French and the British wanted reparations after this war. Wasn't in the 14 points. The League of Nations, which the United States did not join, went ahead and accepted the concept of reparations, which was kind of unfortunate because the person or the country supposed to pay him is Germany. And Germany is undergoing absolutely phenomenally bad currency inflation. This is a 50 million mark note worth $1 in 1923. So things are pretty bad. And in fact, the Germans were docked with a $30 billion reparations thing. The Reparations Commission met in 1921 and said, $30 billion. Well, they couldn't pay that. So they stopped paying, and the French invaded the Ruhr industrial district in Germany and just started pulling the stuff, the coal and stuff, out of there. It was a bad situation. The German economy's collapsed. Besides which, the United States is putting pressure on England and France to pay back their war loans. So, in 1924, the Secretary of the Commerce, Herbert Hoover, put together an international committee of five countries, the finance ministers from five countries, and a couple of Americans. Now, this is all outside the League of Nations, because the League of Nations, we're not part of that. We have nothing to do with it. Charles Dawes, who was an American banker, led the group and came up with a brilliant plan. How about having American investors, bankers and so on, invest in German redevelopment, German industries? So it would look like this. Investment will go over to Germany. Well, that will stimulate Germany's economy to the extent that it can actually pay its reparations. Well, and that's a good deal, because if the British and the French are getting reparations, they can pay their war debt payments. So this is a brilliant plan. It's called the Dawes Plan, 1924. And it worked great. And in fact, in 1928 or 29, Owen Young, who was the other banker at this first meeting, holds a second meeting. They adjusted down what the Germans owed to $9 billion, very doable kind of a thing, and left the system in place. And then what happened? In 1929, the stock market crashed. There's no money available to invest in Germany. There's no money available to invest in the United States. So the investment disappeared, which meant the Germans couldn't pay reparations. And that meant no payment of the war debts. Hoover, who is president now, said, okay, we'll just see what happens. The moratorium turned out to be permanent. So what happened in this situation? We get a thing called autarky. This is a cool word that if you look it up, it just means your economy is basically isolated on your own. Each of these major economies became self-sufficient. The United States is trying to come out of it, and each country chose a different route. The United States chose the New Deal. Great Britain elected a labor government, moved towards socialism. The French had a socialist, communist, so-called popular front government trying to use socialism as a way to go. And what did the Germans have? National socialism, Nazism. And in 1933, Adolf Hitler becomes head of it. And so this economic crisis, which is really an after effect of the Great War, sets up the situation where we're going to have to confront fascism. And meanwhile, the United States is flat on its back. So that's my talk. And I hope you understand why there was a war that nobody should have had, why the United States definitely should never have gotten into it, but why they did anyway, and how the United States benefited enormously from it early in the period. The crisis in the 30s is, of course, down the line. So that's the end of it.